o Lucas Ambrosio, attualmente sta no Imperial College, vai se mudar daqui a pouco para os Estados Unidos, para Chicago, con André. E oggi vai nos falar do Morse Index and Betty Number on Compact Minimum Hypersurface.
Thank you, Espinar. Thank you very much for the invitation. I should say I'm very happy to be back to IMPA. So, as we saw yesterday in Fernando's talk, there are powerful methods of producing minimal hypersurface, which at the same time give you some control on the index. And we also saw in Xiao Li's talk that there are very interesting relationships between the index and the topology of minimal hypersurface in the Euclidean space. So today I want to show you a few results we obtained in collaboration with Alessandro Carlotto. And Ben Sharp about the relationship between the Morse index and the Betty numbers of compact minimal hypersurface. So since I want to deal also with the free boundary case, I would like to start by recalling you some definitions. So I want to consider in a given complete Riemannian manifold the area function on the set of compact hypersurfaces that are properly embedded. And by this, I simply mean that they are embedded in the usual sense and are such that the boundary is precisely the set of points that intersect the boundary of the ambient manifold. Okay? Okay, so since the first step is, of course, to find the critical points, so we need the first variation formula. Given a vector field on N, such that it is tangent to the boundary on the boundary. So if you consider the flow of such vector field, then the flow will preserve this property of proper embeddedness, and the variation of area is given by the formula we saw in Raphael's class. So I have the integral over m of the mean curvature times the vector, and then we have the boundary term, which is the conormal times the vector x integrated on the boundaries. So of course the critical points are therefore minimal zero mean curvature vector, sorry, minimal and the conormal is tangent to the boundary of the ambient manifold. So this is the free boundary condition. If you want a picture, here I have the boundary of N, and then my hypersurface M, and then it meets the boundary orthogonally. Okay, so the next step is, of course, computing the second variation formula. Variation of area. And for simplicity, I will write everything for two-sided minimal hypersurface, so that there is a unit vector field that's normal to M. And then if I take a vector field that is U times N for some function along M, the second variation formula is the following. So I have the integral of the gradient of this function U minus the normal Ricci of the ambient manifold plus the second fundamental form, U square, and the boundary term, which is the integral over the boundary of the second fundamental form of the boundary of the ambient manifold on the normal vector times U square d sigma. Okay, so this formula defines a quadratic form, which I will call the index form. And as a quadratic form, it has an index. So the index of M I will define to be the maximal dimension, of a subspace, a linear subspace, of the set of functions where this form is defined. So you can define it on W12. So maximum dimension of a linear subspace where the restriction of the form is negative definite. OK, so this is a general definition, but there is a more concrete way of computing the index. And so if you integrate by parts this expression, you will see a formula like this, and a boundary term like this. The second formula form times u. And now the index will be the number of negative eigenvalues of the appropriate elliptic equation. So in the case of closed surface, hypersurface, the index is simply the number of negative eigenvalues of this operator, L of M. And if I have boundary, then it is the number of negative eigenvalues of this system. So there is a boundary condition. So I have an equation like this and a boundary condition that makes this zero. So and the point in this case is that this is a nice elliptic boundary condition. So the theory, the spectral theory, works very pretty much like the closed case. OK, so the aim of the talk is to discuss how the index under curvature assumptions on the ambient manifold determine or bound the topology of the minimal surface itself. OK? And by topology, I will mean this talk the Betti numbers. In other words, the dimension of the homology groups P, and also the relative homology in the case of free boundary minimal surfaces. Okay. And of course, once I have a metric on M, I can find canonical representatives in each cohomology class. So this is the content of Hodge theorem. So Hodge theorem will tell us the following. So for example, if I consider the case of surfaces without boundary, then the set of harmonic forms, the set of P forms on M that are closed and co-closed is isomorphic to the space cohomology group. Okay. In the case of surface with boundary, I have to impose appropriate boundary conditions. So there are two natural conditions we can consider. The first one is the following. So I will consider the set of P forms that are closed, co-closed, and that have no normal component on the boundary. Okay, so this contraction is zero. Well, the Hodge theorem will tell us that this space is isomorphic to this cohomology group. Okay. But I can also consider the set of forms that are closed. So let me write. So they are closed, co-closed, sorry, and have no. I mean, they are. They have a normal component on the model, right? So this is isomorphic to the relative cohomology group. Okay, and just to make a connection with more familiar objects. So in the case of surfaces, if there is no boundary, the first set has dimension. So the set of one harmonic one forms has dimension 2 is the genus of the surface. And if there is boundary, then both sets I defined have the same dimension. So they have the same dimension, which is twice the genus plus r minus 1, where r is the number of boundary components. OK? Of course, assuming m is orientable. OK. OK, so let's move on. So the basic idea to establish that relationship is to somehow try to cook up appropriated test functions from harmonic forms. OK? This is the basic idea. OK, so let me show you a few results that can be proved somehow by using these ideas. So the first result I want to state is the result by Shen Yao. And since I want to talk about the free boundary case, let me quote also the work of Shen, Fraser, and Peng. So Shen, Fraser, and Peng. Shen, Fraser, and OK, so the theorem is the following. Consider a three-manifold, orientable three-manifold, that have positive scalar curvature. And if it has some boundary, let's assume it is mean convex. The mean curvature of the boundary is non-negative. OK, so given a compact oriented, properly embedded free boundary minimal surface, if the index is 0, then the genus of this surface is 0, and the number of boundary components is at most 1. In other words, the surface is either topologically a sphere or a disk. Okay? So of course, the original proof of this result is simpler than the one I want to explain. So the idea was just to plug the constant function 1 here. But you can also prove the same result by taking as test function an harmonic form. So the point is that if this is not true, then you can find a non-zero harmonic form in one of those spaces, harmonic form, one form, right? And then if you compute, if you plug the norm of U as a test function, use the Buchner formula and the Gauss equation, you can reach a contradiction because this direction will be a negative direction for the index. Okay, and then I'm assuming there are no negative directions. Okay. Okay, the second result I want to state is the following theorem by Hoss. So Hoss considered minimal surface on flat tori, okay, closed, oriented, minimal surface. And he showed that the index of such surface is bounded from below by 2/3 of the genus of M minus 1. Okay. And the idea of Ross was to use coordinates of harmonic forms as test functions. So coordinates of omega harmonic. In a way that I will explain later. Okay. And finally, I want to state this result by Savo. It's analogous result in the case of the round sphere. So given the round sphere with constant sectional curvature 1, and if I consider a closed minimal hypersurface that is not the equator, and I exclude the equator because, well, it is the only one with index 1. Okay. Then the following inequalities are true. So if in two dimensions, if the dimension is 2, then the index is greater or equal to 2g minus 1 over 4 plus 4. So let me check. Yeah, that's it. And in higher dimensions, he was able to show that the index controls the first bet number. So the first bet number, the index is greater or equal than n plus 1, n plus 2, the first bet number, plus n plus 2. Okay, and in this result, Savo uses the fact that Sn lies in the Euclidean space, and then he considered the coordinates of the following two form, n wedge omega, omega harmonic. Okay, so I believe that partly motivated by those results, Fernando and André made the following conjecture. Fernando Codamarques and André Neves, they proposed the following conjecture. So if I have a closed manifold with positive Ricci curvature, then there should be a constant with the following property. If M is a closed embedded minimal hypersurface on M, then the index of M is bounded from below by this constant times the sum of Betti numbers. Okay, so this dimension these spaces. Okay. And let me remark that there is also a related conjecture about in low dimension, so if n is 2, again positive Ricci. So the conjecture is that index equals to 1 implies genus less than or equal to 2. Okay? And Ross showed that the genus is at most 3. Okay? The conjecture is that the genus is at most 2. Okay, so okay. So before stating the results, our results, let me make two more comments. So it follows from Ben Sharpe's convergence result. It's a very general result, but in the assumptions of the conjecture, under the above assumptions, and if I restrict the dimension to be between 2 and 6, so the set of closed hypersurfaces that have index bounded by a constant k, an area bounded by a constant lambda, is compact. So it contains only finitely many diffeomorphism types. In particular, there is a bound on this sum here. Okay. And let me mention also that in two dimensions we have, in three dimensions we have a better result that follows from this theorem by Chodosh, Ketova, and Maximo. Right, so if n is 2 and the scalar curvature is positive, then a bound on the index implies a bound on the area and on the genus. Okay, so it's a stronger result. So the area is bounded. So the index is bounded by k, the area is bounded by gamma, and the genus is bounded by some constant lambda. Okay. Okay. So now let me state our main results. Okay, where is this? So theorem A is the following. So let's assume n is one of the following spaces. So one of the following spaces. So RP M, CP M, HP M, and the Cayley plane endowed with the canonical matrix. By this I mean the matrix that is symmetric and has positive sectional curvature. Okay? So let's So the second possibility is that N is a graph over the unit sphere S3 in R4 with positive principal curvatures K1, K2, and K3. And let's assume they are pinched in the following way. Square root of 5 over 3. Okay, so then we can bound the first Fermi number in the way described by the conjecture. So then there exists a constant C, depending on the manifold, such that the index of any closed minimal hypersurface is bounded from below by this constant times the first Fermi number. Okay. Okay. And there is a remark here. So in this second case, the constant is such that index 1 implies genus less than 2. Okay, so now let me state the result about free boundary minimal hypersurface. So for simplicity, I will state it in the case of domains in the Euclidean space. So let omega be a domain in the Euclidean space. Let M be a compact oriented properly embedded, of course, free boundary minimal hypersurface. So we have two parts. So if we assume that the boundary is mean convex, strictly mean convex, then the index of M is bounded from below by twice n plus 1, the dimension of this cohomology group. Okay. Okay. And if we assume a stronger condition, so if the boundary is too convex, then the index is bounded by the same number and the maximum between the following two numbers. So the dimension of H1 relative and the dimension of H1. Okay. So a few remarks. Okay, so as I have written here, for two-dimensional surfaces, that number there is twice the genus plus the number of n's minus 1, right? So the index is controlling both the genus and the number of boundary components. Any higher dimensions? It's possible to give an explicit computation, but it's always true that this number is always bounded from below by the number of n's minus 1. Okay, so in particular, for example, this is saying that index 0 is stable minimal, free boundary minimal hypersurfaces. must have at most one boundary component, right? This is somehow similar to the result Shaoli stated yesterday about the result by Chao and Zhu about complete minimal stable hypersurfaces. Okay, so the second remark is that, so Ross has proved this estimate, the case of two dimensions and index one surfaces. And I should also mention that Sargent claimed this lower bound, so the index bounded by this number, in the case of convex domains, okay? And there is a final remark, which is, yes? So the final remark is that we can combine this estimate with a compactness result by Fraser and Lee to conclude. So combining the estimate A with the work of Fraser and Lee, we can conclude that if the boundary of the domain, so in two dimensions, if the boundary is convex, then the set of free boundary minimum hypersurfaces with index bounded by a constant is compact. Okay? So this indicates that some sort of generalization of Ben Sharpe's result to free boundary minimum surfaces will be possible. Okay. Okay. So these are the theorems, the remarks. I have a few more minutes, so let me explain you a little bit about how we prove these results. Okay, so as I said, the basic idea is to find test functions constructed from the harmonic forms that give negative directions. And the starting point was the work of Rosen Salvo, right? And the observation, so the basic idea is that in the same way the round sphere is immersed in the Euclidean space, we can take any Hilbert manifold and isometrically embed in some Euclidean space of big dimension by Nash theorem. And since now we are in the Euclidean space, we can do as Salvo and Ross and compute the coordinates of forms with respect to the constant basis of the Euclidean space, right? So so the test functions are coordinates omega, any wedge omega. And then we did the computation and found a general condition that if it is satisfied, then you find that constant and you get this type of inequality, right? So this general condition, this general criterion, depends on the intrinsic metric, but also on this isometric embedding, right? So, for example, this is our obvious situation where you have a nice embedding, you can try to do the computation. The computation is successful. And in this case, there is also a somehow canonical family of isometric embeddings. And it turns out that they are suitable for the technique. OK. And I have 5 more minutes, maybe. And so let me show you. So since the method is somehow very general, this method that Savo and Ross used, I want to explain it, and perhaps you will find it interesting. So this will be essentially the same explanation Xiao Li gave us yesterday, but I want to formulate it a little bit different. So let me write that. So general idea. So let me deal with the boundaryless case for simplicity. So let's say you are lucky to find, suppose that there exists some functions that take a P form, a harmonic P form, on a function on M, right? And let's assume these functions are linear. And let's assume that you do the following computation. So you take the sum on those test functions, and you find it is negative for all harmonic form that is non-zero, okay? Let's assume you are lucky to find such set of functions. If the index of M is k, let's say, let us take L2 orthonormal basis of eigenfunctions for the problem, for the stability operator. So orthonormal basis of eigenfunctions. Okay, and the point now is to take the following balancing map. So the balancing map is a function that takes each P form on the following matrix, if you like. So the matrix is F I omega times phi j, where I goes between 1 and d, and j goes between 1 and the index, okay? So, and the point is that this map is linear as well. Since it's linear, of course the dimension of the domain is equal to the dimension of the kernel plus the dimension of the image, which is less or equal than the index times d. Okay, so I'm almost there. I just need to prove that the kernel is trivial. But if a form lies on the kernel, this means that these functions are orthogonal to the first k eigenfunctions, right? So by the variational characterization of the eigenvalues by Courant, so I should find this inequality for each fi omega. So this squared is less than or equal than qm of fi omega, fi omega. And this should be greater or equal than 0 because the index is k. So now I sum. And by star, the only possible way of this to happen is that omega is zero, right? So the kernel is trivial, okay? So this is somehow a very flexible method. The problem is, of course, to find functions satisfying this condition. And in those particular cases, we were able to find the appropriate test functions. Okay, thank you.
Any question? ¿Alguna pregunta? ¿Comentario?